the ways in which we unwittingly perpetuate racism through our structures, through our, even through our spirituality.
Those very same counties that overproduce debt, right, are the same counties that clear the fewest felonies, lowest percentage of felonies.
And they really don't have much context or history about the salience of race as an issue in the United States.
I'm Brian Wade. Watch me every week on this station.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, culture, and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that, in a lot of ways, have continued to perpetuate some of the polarization within our society around an issue such as race, a topic that, in a lot of ways, elements in America feel that we've done a better job. But when you look at a lot of the research out of schools like Harvard, the Civil Rights Project report by Dr. Gary Orfield, a lot of the other research, it talks about really in a lot of ways the regression in terms of the progress that we've made supposedly during the period of the Civil Rights in the 50s and 60s with respect to the achievement gap, to housing policies, and around just a lot of issues, the economics, the mobility within corporate America in terms of upper and middle management types of placements. So in a lot of ways, the program is not trying to be malicious or mean-spirited in addressing these issues, but to serve as a constructive dialogue piece so we can get a sense about where are we and how can we truly move forward if we want to address these issues, because I've always contended that if we can do well as a general society, then we all do better, and America's a better place for everyone. So why wouldn't we want to create opportunities for all of our citizens to do well? It doesn't seem like that's rocket science, but we continue to grapple with these economic disparities, and here today, we're favored to have, I would call them recidivists, repeat offenders on the program. They were on back in 2004, and I have the ability to track who watches the program for my website. And I was going back through over the last maybe 3 or 4 months, and at the top of the list was always the Ivy Planning Group. I said, well, you know what? I think I better call Gary and Janet and see if they want to come back on and give update on what's happening, because it was just interesting. I know there was some interest, but to stay at the top of the charting, I think there's probably like 30 places on that analysis, and to see consistently that your program was at the top says something to me that evidently somebody's interested in terms of corporate diversity and what's going on within corporate America. And these two people are some of the leading consultants and diagnosticians or assessment providers or gatherers in the United States, if not around the world, internationally, and going to corporations and helping them retrofit. So at this time, I'd like to introduce good friends of mine, Gary Smith and Janet Crenshaw Smith, as she said back in 2004. Welcome to Worlds Apart.
Thanks, Brian. Thanks for having us.
Yes. Give us some background about yourself for somebody who might not have saw that land-breaking program back in 2004. But go ahead, Gary.
Well, back 17 years ago, we started a management consulting firm that focused specifically on diversity as a bottom-line business issue. And at the time, the real critical issue was to demonstrate to corporate America primarily how diversity could be an enabler of business success.
Okay. Janet?
Hi, good to be back, Brian. Thank you again. Janet Crenshaw Smith, founding partner and president of Ivy Planning Group. And in fact, in 2008, we celebrate our 18th year in business. So we are, it's almost adulthood.
Right.
And it has been a great experience in terms of working with some of the world's largest firms, Fortune 500 and public sector agencies, on this topic of diversity as an enabler.
And if I remember back from 2004, you're a graduate of Yale and you're a graduate of Harvard.
That's true.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Very good. Just to give a little academic perspective for the both of them, they're quite competent. Here, I'm getting ready to say quite proficient, but quite competent in what they do in terms of this area of work. But I want to thank you for coming up from Maryland. We weren't quite sure if the storm, you know, this is December the 17th, though, and we were wondering if a storm was going to sort of cause you to be represented via picture, but I'm glad that I have you in person. And then your sons are here, too. Give us the name of your children. They're grown now, I believe, right?
Right. Two of our three sons are here today, okay. Alex and Gary.
Okay. And one's an orangeman from Syracuse, and the other one's a Morehouse man, correct?
Yes, that's
right.
Correct.
Okay, and your youngest son?
Youngest son is Bradley, and he's a senior in high school.
Okay. Yeah. Where's he going to go to school?
That's a great question, Brian.
Yes.
Not yet.
We have no clue.
No clue.
He's blessed to have lots of choices.
Yes. Oh, okay. So, okay.
And we'll be blessed to have three in college at once.
Oh, okay. So it gives you more time to sort of have some fun around the house and whatever, do whatever.
That'll work.
Yeah, that's right. It's called three tuitions, Brian.
That's right.
So the fun or the work shifts from in the house to outside the house now.
That's right.
Okay. Well, I thank both of you for being on the program. And I just in some ways wanted to get an update on terms of where we at in America, because you're not only regionally, you're national. Have you done international work yet?
We have.
Yes, okay. We have. In fact, global diversity is something that we like to talk about because it's something that has hit the radar screen in a huge way with our clients. And Ivy, and of course, Ivy is a team of consultants and is keeping us very busy, both in the U.S. and outside the U.S.
Okay,
as well.
Great. Well, you know, congratulations and much success in terms of the work that you're doing. But I know I wanted to talk about a couple of things as this sort of concept of diversity continues to evolve. And I know you were on in 2004. So what's changed between 2004? I know it's a very broad question regarding your work and specifically in the area of diversity, you know, Gary and Janet.
Sure. I think a couple of things to keep in mind. There's been enormous progress around the conversation for a number of reasons. One, diversity is the way I like to explain it. You know, in 2004, we talked about a demographic shift that was coming. Mm-hmm. That demographic shift is here. It's happened. And so when you look at the demographics of our nation, when you look at the demographics around the world, we are simply a more diverse society than we've ever been throughout the history of mankind.
And for clarity's sake, demographic meaning demographic ethnic shifts?
Ethnic shifts, cultural shifts, gender shifts.
Okay.
For example, everything from, you know, 85% of the net new entrants to the workforce are women and people of color.
Okay.
Or you look at the fact that we now have four generations working in the workplace at the exact same time. Ooh. We've never had that before, and that creates enormous stress on the way organizations operate. Mm-hmm. So the biggest change is the fact that the demographic shift that we kept alluding to has happened. So now most corporations are asking the question, it's not a matter of how do I find this diversity. This diversity is around me now. The question is, can I effectively lead it, and can I produce the business results I want, given that the world has changed right around me?
Well, Gary, let me stop. Let me see if I can effectively go to break. So what I need to do is go to break to acknowledge our corporate sponsors. But if you're just now tuning in, I have Gary Smith and Janet Smith, who are my guests, and they are the founding partners of the Ivy Planning Group, located in Rockville, Maryland, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, and we'll give you their address information, contact information later on in the program. So what I'd like to do now is pause some words from our sponsors. Stay tuned, we'll be back to Worlds Apart.
Looking to buy or sell your home? Contact Monica Archie. Several years of real estate experience. Make the right choice for your realtor for life. Monica Archie.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by The Bonton.
Hi, my name is Dr. Stephen Jones, and I've written a wonderful book titled 7 Secrets of How to Study. How many of you have a student that's struggling in school, trying to take tests, thinking about their motivation level, knowing that they're not ready or able to get the types of grades that they would like? Well, I've written this book, 7 Secrets of How to Study, to show them what they need to do to manage their time, to get organized, and to make sure that they're eliminating all stresses as they're preparing for each individual test. I've also written a book for parents to help parents know how to organize and help their students to do better in school. And I'm writing a scholarship book that should be forthcoming. I want you to have a student that knows exactly what they need to do when they go to every class, how they should manage their time, how they should prepare for difficult examinations, and let them know that there's a resource that they can do to train themselves to do better in every class. You have potential to be successful if you will use this book, and you will have an A on every class.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just not tuning in, I have with me, I think as I said in 2004, the tag team partner. Seems like my mind keeps going back to that program, but that was a lot of fun. We did a couple of programs. The partnering group of Janet and Gary Smith, and they're the co-founders or the founding partners of the Ivy Planning Group located in Rockville, Maryland. We were talking, and you were really honing in on the demographic shifts via gender, ethnicity, and what were the other groups within that?
And then certainly generational.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Continue what you were talking about, Gary, if you would.
Well, the challenge is that now that it's happened, what happens to a leadership team, what happens to an organization is the question of how do we manage it, how do we lead it. So I have to attract talent to want to work for my organization. I have to convince people mine is the right organization to join. At the same time, I've got to figure out how do I keep them, because otherwise I just become a training ground for folks, but I can't keep them excited, right, and they're not going to want to stay in my organization. Mm-hmm. So most corporations have figured that out. That's sort of the low-hanging fruit, if you will. They understand that they have to do it. So that's one of the big changes now. You're not having many conversations where I'll talk to a CEO who doesn't understand in principle that diversity makes sense. The question now is one of practice. How do I operationalize it? How do I make it work in a way that really is going to be effective over the long haul? That's where most organizations are still struggling. Mm-hmm. And there's still a tendency, quite frankly, that when we think of difference, we process it as less than. We tend to say that which is different isn't as good as, or quite frankly, it might even be inferior to the norm, whatever I define that norm to be. So our need to make sure that we elevate and constantly elevate the definition of diversity as not being less than, but actually being equal to or greater than, because it's that difference that creates competitive advantage. But most organizations don't understand that.
Jen, let me ask you, though, in terms of your ability to be brought on as consultants to various corporations, is it because it's almost like you're preaching to the choir there? They say, okay, we need this, we're comfortable with this now. Or is it for some like pulling teeth, or how would you respond to that, you know, in terms of the opportunities you've had to, you know, network with a lot of corporations?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's a mix. Without question, as Gary said, companies now understand that diversity is a reality, whether they are hiring from college campuses where the majority of graduates across college campuses are females. That's a big difference. Even if you go back 20 years, that was not true. So they know that that's true. If they are hiring for professional hires, they see that there's just a different reality in terms of the talent that they see. So they know it's no longer a matter of convincing large corporations or even small corporations that you are pulling from a more diverse talent base. Even if we're talking on the customer side, clearly the marketplace has changed. We're now talking about the spending power of African Americans and Latinos and Asians that has significantly increased. And with that comes a customer that's more likely to say, this product was not built with me in mind. You're not treating me well as a customer. So across the board, the reality is that the talent base is different and the marketplace is speaking louder. So that's a significant difference for us as consultants, because it's not a matter of convincing companies that they need us. It's more coming in and saying, are you ready for the change process that you need to go through in order to address the pain that you're feeling?
Mm-hmm. Well, but what I hear still in terms of, now, if companies say they're are ready for the change, has that translated in terms of upward mobility into upper and middle management positions for people of color, specifically African American males, and also in the boardroom? If they're ready for this change, what are the numbers saying?
No, they're ready for it to be better. That's what it is. They're ready for the pain to go away.
Okay.
They're not necessarily ready for the change process they need to go through in order to make it better. Like anyone else, you know, no one is going to really say, yeah, I want to change, although we know that we need to. So it's that same kind of situation. With regard to the talent at the top of the organizations, no, we're not seeing the kind of changes that we want to see.
So, and I guess that this is being kind of hard, but then really, are they perpetuating a fraud saying we're ready for change, but it's limited or strategic kinds of change and not really holistic change?
Well, I think there's a slightly different way to think about it, and it's the CEO's challenge. The CEO believes that the day they say something, it's happened. They believe it's true. They believe that from the moment they said it, it's done. Well, what CEOs are discovering now is companies have learned not to listen. So from the time that they make that statement, that claim that they want to be different, they want to be better, now what they have to do is figure out, how do I make that happen? So no, we're not seeing representation in the boardroom, nor are we seeing representation in the C-suite that we would expect. It's lagging. There's no question there's a lag. But what we are seeing is a commitment to a different level of development and a different level of competitiveness that forces the issue. In other words, if I want to be successful in diverse markets, then I am going to have to hire people that reflect those markets. Mm-hmm. And I can't simply hire them at the bottom of the organization, because I won't stay at the bottom if I don't see someone that looks like me at the top.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask this question then. And I know you talked about, there's this conversation about the globalization within the workforce. Do you think that globalization then has a direct correlation or tie to the kinds of people they're hiring then? If there's this influx of people from different ethnic groups that are finding their way into these kinds of upper and middle management positions, is that why maybe certain groups are being excluded, or you still don't see that
Again, I think we have the same challenge. What happens is we want to operate in a global economy because we want the revenue streams that come from a global economy. Mm-hmm. What corporate America hasn't figured out yet is, what do those new joint ventures have to look like? What do those new partnerships have to look like? I can no longer simply land in another country, extract the dollars, extract the revenue, and then do business my way. Mm-hmm. So part of the diversity conversation says, I have to look like those same markets I'm going to operate in, even globally. So the challenge is, to your point, how do I create a joint venture in another country where ownership interests are going to be different, and maybe I'm going to have to change the way I like to do business? Mm-hmm. That's the discomfort that Janet's talking about.
Rick, because I think in one hand, and I'll move away from this, within the African-American community, they say it's a several hundred billion dollar collective industry.
Yes, yes.
Isn't that enough for corporate America to say, hey, can't we do better with this? We got 30 seconds. So what we're going to do is, I'll get to that question when we come back. He said he won't let that go, will he? But anyway,
no, it's a good question.
What we're going to do is pause. And again, I'm so happy to see my friends from Rockville, Maryland, Janet and Gary Smith. They're the co-founders of the Ivy Planning Group. What we'd like to do now is pause some words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be back to World Apart.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
At WellSpan Health, we understand what women need and what women want. That's why we've created something unique for our region: healthcare programs, diagnostics, and treatments exclusively for women. We call it Well Women at WellSpan. Special care and insightful information for everything from high-risk pregnancies to midlife health and more. Well Women at WellSpan. Don't you love it when someone really understands your needs?
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just now tuning in, I have with me as my guests Gary Smith and Janet Smith, who are the co-founders of the Ivy Planning Group. And they're my guests. And they said, Brian, you've grabbed onto something. You don't seem like you don't want to let it go. Mm-hmm. But I was talking about really this hesitancy and even a lot of ways of resistance. You have the African-American community that is a $7 billion entity and a several billion dollar entity of itself. But yet that has not translated, in my opinion, and you could correct me if I'm wrong, in terms of opportunities within corporate America. Dan, you want to respond to that? Are you saying the same thing?
We are. And one of the concerns is that we are talking about a huge market opportunity, but we're also talking about people of color not necessarily making their voices heard. Mm-hmm. So again, when the pressure is applied in a way that the corporations can hear it, then they're clear that they need to make a move. Mm-hmm. more often what happens is it's quiet, it's underground. People will complain, but they won't necessarily go to the companies to say, wait a minute, these are my expectations. That's where we tell our clients, that's where the opportunity is for them, to make sure that they understand the marketplace and that they can really capture it. But today it's not happening, so it's not translating.
Gary, one of my contentions is, as I look over the last 40 years and look at the civil rights movement and how it's evolved, there seemed to be more of that advocacy, verbal and, you know, strategic advocacy. Do you think we've become complacent in general? I can't, broadly or pejoratively speak up, but do you think we've, in the black or minority community, have come strategically complacent?
Well, quite frankly, some of that's just being successful. I mean, we've had some successes.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And as a result of our successes, we've started to forget how we got those successes. Mm-hmm. We've possibly forgotten the struggle that it took. But also, I think there's been another shift that we need to acknowledge, and it's an economic shift. Mm-hmm. You know, we do need to spend more time talking about economic realities, and that says that we're going to have different partnerships and strategic alliances. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if you look at that last wave, the civil rights era, that was clearly driven by the church. Mm-hmm. The church had a critical, pivotal role in that progress. This time around, I could make a case that corporate America is going to be a critical place for that change to take place.
Okay.
They have the resources. They have the economic capacity to hire us. They have the economic capacity to build products that serve us and to engage us as a market. If we hold them accountable, if we apply the proper pressures, if we make ourselves available as talent, because they are going to need our talent to succeed, mm-hmm. then corporate America becomes a huge opportunity for facilitating change. Mm-hmm. But it means that we have to engage corporate America. It means we have to go at them, hold them accountable, and be very, very aggressive about the opportunities we seek.
Right. And it has to be a partnership. Like you said, it has to be a true partnership. It can't be a matter of corporate America using us. After all, we are the dollars that are fueling corporate America. So it can't be a matter of corporate America using people of color, using those communities and the creativity to assist them in their bottom line without the opportunity flowing in our community. So it has to be a true partnership. But since both of us have power, it's something that could be a huge win-win.
All right, very good. Well, we'll continue more of that conversation in part two, but I wanted to talk about additionally a lot of your successes and what's happened over the last 4 years in terms of the accolades that you received. Talk about that, if you would, please, Gary or Janet.
Well, I guess we'll take turns on this one for sure.
Right.
My job is to talk about the fact that Janet has written another great book.
Okay.
And again, it's a book about micro-triggers. And micro-triggers are these subtle behaviors, these things that happen to you in the world.
That's the book right
That's
there?
That's the book.
Yeah, we're
going to
put it up on the screen.
All right.
Yeah, we'll put it up on the screen.
And Janet has written another successful book, and micro-triggers is getting a lot of recognition. And there's a lot of traction around the book because it resonates with everyone. Because these are these subtle behaviors that we're all guilty of. These are these things that just set us off and really do impact the way we either feel valued by an organization or the way we feel devalued. Mm-hmm. You know, my big micro trigger is when I travel and I sit in first class and they ask me to see my ticket. You know, that's the one that makes me crazy. You know, someone else's micro-trigger.
That sounds very soft, micro-trigger, compared to what I was saying. What's up with that, man? You discriminate against me when you call a micro-trigger.
Right.
Okay.
But it's, you know what, and it's subtle. You know, right okay. now we're really focusing on some huge things that are going on. You know, we have the Don Imus, who certainly, I mean, was just horrific in terms of his comments and is now back on the air.
Yep.
We have nooses that are still showing up.
Yes.
Those are huge.
Mm-hmm.
Those are important. Mm-hmm. But they also tend to be relatively rare, compared to some of these subtle things that are quite frequent, mm-hmm. and have an impact. And so it's really important to understand that the huge things matter, but also the subtle ways that we treat each other, or particularly are treated in the workplace, to demonstrate that we're not valued, have an impact. They burn at us, and then we do go off.
Give us a couple of the micro-triggers that you talk about in your book, Dan.
Let's see. Well, the one that we call the honorary Joe Biden, Senator Obama, is referring to you as articulate.
Okay.
You know what, Brian? You're so articulate.
Thank you.
You speak so well.
You speak so well.
All right, right. Like that's limited to a particular ethnic group.
Right.
Or like that.
Or it's a matter of, and what did you expect?
Yeah, what were your expectations?
Yeah. So, or interrupting
okay.
you.
Okay, okay, right. Wow, okay. Well, like I said, that's interesting. You say it's getting a lot of...
Yes.
I mean, I might maybe have you come back on the program just to focus solely on that book and to give some more detailed information about that book. But they how can they purchase that book?
Well, we should put it on your site.
Okay,
they can
sure.
Purchase it on your site.
Yep, definitely.
It's also at microtriggers.com.
Okay. Very good. Yeah. Boy, I tell you, I got to hang around you guys. You have so many different ideas of like that. I said that. Well, you know, in a lot of ways, that's how wealth is sort of, you know, perpetuated. You know, you get with people that, you know, have good ideals and have, mm-hmm. you know, can obtain wealth, and we need to sort of take that model. But give us some more of the accolades that's been going on in terms of your awards, please.
Well, for Gary, it's huge. Okay. Consulting Magazine, which is the magazine for the consulting profession worldwide, every year honors 25 of his top, it selects 25 top consultants.
Okay.
And it's out of the traditional consulting firms like Booz Allen and Accenture and A.T. Kearney, mm-hmm. where this year they selected Gary Smith as one of the 25.
And we're going to put that up on the screen, that particular magazine.
So we're hugely proud, particularly because it demonstrates also that diversity strategy is recognized as being critical mm-hmm. to corporations worldwide.
Right. Any other awards?
And then we were both named Diversity Pioneers by Profiles in Diversity Journal.
Okay.
So it's been quite a year, and we're actually, you know, we're delighted for the recognition personally, but also for our clients.
Right. Definitely.
Because it shows that we're actually making change happen.
That's great. Well, I'm privileged to have you on the program in terms of your work. I think it's important work. In so many ways, I see these contradictions, you know, regarding a lot of issues. So
yes.
It's not only relevant to corporate America, and the question is how we can create more congruency or more, you know, continuity in terms of trying to level the playing field. And sometimes I wonder if America or the world will ever get it right, you know, and maybe it's naive for me to think that we can have an equitable society or world.
Got to get it right.
Right.
Let me give you some encouragement to see if that
right.
helps.
We got 8 seconds, so
go ahead. Since the last time we were on your show, I can promise you, it's getting better.
Oh, is it getting better?
It's getting
absolutely.
Better.
We're not worlds apart?
No.
We're not,
no.
Okay.
No.
All right. So what I need to do is end our program. So stay tuned for part two in our series. For World's Part, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless. Thank you.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, who was the first African American woman to fly in space? Today's featured African American is Dr. Julian Earls. Director of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration's Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio. As director, Dr. Earls is responsible for planning, organizing, and directing the activities required to accomplish the missions assigned to the center.
When you learn the history of a people, you gain greater respect for those people. When you learn your own history, you gain greater respect for yourself.
He was torchbearer for the 2002 Winter Olympics and has twice received NASA medals for exceptional achievement and leadership.
If the history books told the truth about Black history, we would not need Black History Month.
Who was the first African-American woman to fly in space? The answer is Mae Jemison. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders of giants.